Protect, report, preserve, stopping abuse against persons with disability. Welcome to Naugatuck Resource Associates training on reporting suspected abuse against persons with disabilities and preventing abuse against persons with disabilities. The following is our agenda for this training. I'm going to talk a little bit about prevalence of violence. How is violence possible? Risk factors, recognizing crime, abuse, and neglect, and what to do and what not to do, mandated reporting, and then we'll follow up with a post-test. Vulnerability of persons with disabilities. Persons with disabilities are our most vulnerable citizens. Why? Vulnerability of persons with disabilities is heightened when they are dependent on a caregiver. Some of the reasons for this is that frequently people with disabilities need assistance with ADLs, bathing, dressing, and personal hygiene. This may diminish their capacity to utilize self-defense and avoidance of violent mechanisms. Misinterpretations that people with disabilities cannot form relationships and are not interested in or engage in consensual sex also increases their vulnerability. Many times, there can be a public perception that people with disabilities are not capable of understanding or communicating what happened to them, making them easy targets. As a result, when a person discloses their victimization, they're frequently not believed. This can lead to underreporting of incidents, lack of belief in disclosure of abuse, and the potential for statistics. Crime, abuse, and neglect committed against persons with disabilities are a frequently unrecognized and underreported problem. According to a 2000 study, 5 million crimes are committed against people with disabilities annually, compared to 1.4 million child abuse cases and 1 million elder abuse cases. Statistics continued. More than 90% of developmentally disabled individuals, both male and female, will experience sexual abuse at some point in their life. Of those individuals, 49%, almost half, will experience 10 or more abuse incidents. Only 3% of all sexual abuse incidents will ever be reported. Women with disabilities are raped, assaulted, and abused at rates more than 2 times greater than women without disabilities. Adults with developmental disabilities are at a risk for being physically or sexually assaulted at rates 4 to 10 times greater than other adults. A study of psychiatric inpatients found that 81% of patients have been physically or sexually assaulted. 62% of women with physical disabilities reported experiencing emotional, physical, or sexual abuse. Risk factors. Knowing how a person can be at risk will help us to intervene quickly and even prevent abuse or neglect. Risk factors. Many people with disabilities may have restricted social environments. Many may feel powerless. Some may depend on touch for personal care and not be able to control the nature of the care or touch. Many may be socialized to accept being touched by anyone called staff. People with disabilities may not be able to differentiate between appropriate and inappropriate touch. Some may not understand the concept of strangers, and it may be difficult to conceive the fact that someone they know and trust would harm them. Many people with disabilities may not have received sexual education. Many may be particularly disadvantaged when trying to tell others or communicate the abuse. Some may rely on others for decision-making in their best interests. Many people with disabilities may live or work in a situation where compliant behavior is required or considered normal. Disclosures of abuse are more likely to be ignored when made by individuals with disabilities. They tend to be considered less credible. Primary indicators of abuse, such as bruising, are or may be attributed to the disability itself. Secondary indicators of abuse, such as isolation or social impairment, are also attributed to the disability frequently. Some people feel that people with disabilities are not as harmed by abuse. They do not feel the pain the same way. Some individuals with disabilities are highly dependent on their caregivers for daily care. As a result, they are reluctant to report abuse due to fear of retribution, neglect, or isolation. Some family members or guardians of individuals with disabilities may have a false sense of security about the safety of their loved ones. They believe they are safer in supervised settings. Recognizing crime, abuse, and neglect committed against persons with disabilities. Types of abuse. There are 5 types of abuse: physical, sexual, financial, neglect or omission, and emotional. Indicators of physical abuse: puncture wounds, bruises reported to be of an accident when other bruises do not support the story, bruises in various stages of healing, from fresh to faded, multiple bruises forming patterns or clusters, such as bruising on both shoulders, forearms, or legs, bruises in the shape or size of a familiar object, hand or belt buckle, etc. Bruises routinely occur after certain events such as home visits, stressful family times or staff visits, and human bite marks. Other indicators of physical abuse can include fractures to legs, skull, ribs, or arms, unexplained internal injuries, bilateral bruises, same place on both arms or legs, etc., burns the same shape of familiar objects, such as an iron or electric burner, small burns in the shape of cigarette marks, especially on the soles of the feet, palms, or back, scalding burns caused by hot water, and burns showing a clear boundary line from immersion in hot liquid, foot burns up to the ankle resembling socks is an example. Burn marks on the fingers or toes, abrasion marks from rope or other restraints, especially on arms, legs, neck, hands, ankles, or mouth. Sprains, dislocations, fractures, and/or broken bones involving ribs, skull, arm, legs, or neck. Unexplained internal injuries, cuts, lacerations, puncture wounds, unexplained chipped teeth, ulcers in the mouth from chemicals or poisoning. Tears or swelling in the mouth, possibly from forced feeding. Indicators of sexual abuse: torn or stained clothes, stained bed or bedding, difficulty walking or sitting, vaginal or rectal bleeding, itching, swelling, or pain in the genital areas, vaginal infections or STDs, bruising in the genital area or inner thighs, incontinence, pregnancy, HIV or AIDS, and vacant stares or daydreaming, fantasizing. More indicators of sexual abuse can include fear of the dark, nightmares, disturbed sleep, extreme changes in behavior, bedwetting, sexual promiscuity, dressing provocatively, unexplained money or gifts following contact with a certain caregiver, fear of a person or place, fear of being left alone or going home, frequent bathing, refusal to disrobe for bedtime or shower in front of trusted caregivers, aggressive or disruptive behaviors, running away, shy, withdrawn, isolated, depressed, or crying, talk of suicide attempts, excessive interest in pornography, abusing alcohol or drugs, engaging in illegal activities, asking another adult if she or he can live with them. Statements or gestures indicating sophisticated sexual knowledge for age or development. Indicators of neglect can include patient-on-patient abuse, dehydration, malnourishment, inadequate food storage or spoiled food, inadequate food supplies, water that is unpalatable or unavailable, bed sores, evidence of poor hygiene, lack of clothing or improperly clothed for the weather, untreated medical or medical conditions, medical mismanagement, as in not giving medications, lack of needed medical assistance devices, no toilet or commode available, inadequate living conditions, inadequate heating or ventilation, inadequate sanitation, a heating system that is dangerous, animal or insect infestation, very crowded living spaces, unsafe housing structures, architectural barriers, fire hazards being present, hazardous substances, and no telephone or access to outside help. More indicators of neglect can include restraint devices are evident, drugs or liquor around, or even beer bottles being evident, frequent moves between residences being made, the caregiver fails to wash or bathe the victim, shop or prepare meals, launder or dress or change the person, assist the victim to the bathroom or the commode, administer medications, change bedpans. The caregiver evicts or abandons the victim, or the caregiver leaves the victim unsupervised. Indicators of financial abuse can include a substantial increase in an account activity, particularly a joint account. The account holder is accompanied by people who appear to coax or pressure the person to make transactions. People speaking for the individual. The individual does not have enough money for basic needs. The individual is confused about missing funds in their accounts. A sudden increase in checking overdrafts. An unusually large cash withdrawal or transfer, and the individual cannot obtain account information from the person assisting them, like checkbooks or passbooks. More indicators of financial abuse can include that the individual signs blank checks with large amounts filled out by another person. Someone else forges the individual's signature. The individual claims expense items are missing. The individual expresses fear of abandonment if they do not pay the caregiver. The individual appears under duress, making withdrawals. The caregiver seeks to cash individual's disability or paycheck. The individual complains about not having access to their funds. The caregiver charging personal items to the individual's credit card. The caregiver spending money for their own personal use. The caregiver coercing an individual to pay for their own expenses. Caregiver coercing an individual to give away property. The caregiver coercing an individual to sign legal documents to sign over control of their funds. Withholding an individual's funds. The individual is coerced to name a specific insurance beneficiary. The person is not allowing an individual to access financial or legal matters with others. And the caregiver mismanaging or misappropriating funds for their own use. Indicators of emotional abuse. Screaming, cursing, or yelling, shouting, threatening of violence, threatening withdrawal of food or shelter or care, name-calling or belittling, cruel teasing, mimicking, making discriminatory remarks, ridiculing culture or heritage, belittling, degrading, using demeaning labels, telling lies, generally harassing the person, sexually harassing the person, humiliation, intimidating gestures or posture. Mandated reporters. People, due to their profession, are more likely to be aware of the signs of abuse in the mandated reporters. What is mandated reporting? certain people are required by law to report any suspected abuse of disabled persons to the Disabled Persons Protection Commission if the person being reported about is between 18 years old and 64 years old, to the Elder Abuse Hotline if they're 65 years old or older, or to the Department of Children and Families if they are under 18 years old. Who are mandated reporters? Employees of state agencies through the Executive Office of Health and Human Services, and employees of private agencies, state personnel and examiners, social workers, foster parents, police, probation workers, dentists and doctors, educational administration and teachers, psychologists, daycare workers, and guidance or family counselors. What is reportable? The standard for reporting is reasonable cause to believe, which means mere suspicion of abuse or neglect. So if you suspect abuse or neglect, then you must report it to the correct authority. In addition to reporting abuse and neglect, all mandated reporters are required to report to DPPC, Elder Abuse Hotline, or DCF, all incidents in which a person with a disability has died. Difficulties for victims. Victims may be sharing very personal or very private information when reporting abuse or neglect, may have intense feelings of fear, shame, or guilt, be afraid to tell and have you do nothing. They may be afraid to be blamed for the incident that occurred. They may be fearful of violating caregivers or abusers' orders. They may be afraid of threats to further harm them or their loved ones. They may be very dependent on the abuser. They may be fearful of being left without a home or family. They may be afraid to get the caregiver or abuser in trouble. And they may be unable to fully explain what happened, given the nature of their disability. Difficulties for professionals to report. Professionals may be shocked, angered, or embarrassed at what they see or hear. They may hear information contrary to their own beliefs or standards. They may be unclear about their responsibility to report. Professionals may be fearful about being brought into a legal matter. They may be fearful of their reputation being questioned. They may not want to get involved. They may fear retaliation by an abuser. The abuser may be a friend or a coworker. They may feel that reporting may make the situation worse. They may fear that they can alienate the caregiver. And they may fear that they're breaking the code of silence. Protection for mandated reporters. Mandated reporters are immune from civil or criminal liability as a result of filing a report with DPPC, Elder Abuse Hotline, or DCF. Non-mandated reporters are also protected, providing the report was filed in good faith. If a mandated reporter is retaliated against by their employer for filing an alleged report of abuse or by participating in the DPPC investigation, DPPC will also investigate the retaliation. Mandated reporting. The law also provides for punishment for not reporting. Mandated reporters can be fined up to $1,000 for not reporting abuse. Mandated reporting, the do's and don'ts. You suspect or have been informed of abuse and neglect. What do you do now? The do's and don'ts. Do. Stay calm and remain non-judgmental. Be supportive. Stay close to provide security. Assure the individual that they did the right thing. Ensure the individual's safety. Explain the requirements to report to DPPC. Assure the victim that someone will be with them to help them through the investigation. Seek privacy if possible. Listen closely and let the victim talk. Get the facts. What happened? Where? When? Who? dues continued. Gather and document basic information. Whenever possible, collect relevant logs, schedule correspondence, files, etc. Prevent loss or destruction of any evidence. Contain and control the situation. Ensure all allegations are not repeated to others. Do not agree to keep the information secret. Conduct your own investigation. Bathe the victim of sexual assault or rape if the assault is immediate. Change the clothes of an alleged victim of a rape or sexual assault. Do not wash the bed linens or clothes of an alleged victim of a sexual assault or rape. Clean the location of the abuse or rape. Re-interview the individual. Interpret or edit the information. Interview or involve others. Look for or touch any physical. Operationalizing this training. Nonatuck's mission, slogan, policy, and reporting mechanisms all operationalize this training. Nonatuck's mission statement is Nonatuck Resource Associates and our affiliates link with communities to create conditions for inclusion and social change. In order for that to occur, people cannot be abused and neglected. Nonatuck has an abuse and neglect policy that is located in the policy manual. It is mandatory for all employees to review and know our abuse and neglect policy. Reporting abuse. Any person receiving services from Nonatuck Resource Associates who is over 18 years old and under the age of 65 and has experienced abuse or neglect, it must be reported to the Disabled Persons Protection Commission, DPPC. These brochures should be located in each program and are available. If a person is over 65 years old, the suspected abuse or neglect must be reported to the Elder Abuse Hotline. If the person is receiving services funded through the Department of Developmental Services, the abuse or neglect must also be reported through a HCSIS incident report. If the person is receiving funding through AFC, the abuse or neglect must also be reported through the MassHealth Community Services Critical Incident Reporting Form. Thank you.